Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. All the rights secured to the citizens under the Constitution are worth nothing and a mere bubble, except guaranteed to them by an independent and virtuous judiciary. With these words of Andrew Jackson, the 7th President of the United States, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to Honorable Mr. Justice Vineet Kumar Mathur, Judge High Court of Rajasthan at Jodhpur, respected Professor and Director, Amity Law School and Dean Faculty of Law, Major General P.K. Sharma, faculty members, students, and other participants present here today. Judiciary has been mandated to uphold the rule of law and administer justice according to law. Our constitution and judicial system is a key aspect of our democratic way of life and is instrumental in upholding peace, order, and good governance. Citizens look to the judiciary to uphold their rights, and governments look to the courts to interpret laws. Judiciary is the guardian of the human rights, protector of the constitution, and promoter of peace and cordiality in India, and must therefore act without fear of powerful interests and without favoring individual parties. The exercise of judicial review, whereby the judiciary decides on constitutional matters, either to validate or invalidate legislative or executive action, is pivotal in its role of upholding the constitutional mandate. The past year has disrupted life as we knew it, and has also seen the judiciary play an important role in balancing the rights of people and administrative action. With a view to better understand the role of judiciary in today's environment, Amity Law School presents a webinar on role of judiciary in upholding constitutional mandate. The vision and mission of Amity Law School Gurugram is to strive to be an internationally recognized leader in socially relevant legal research and education in India, in alignment with the vision of Amity University, Haryana, which strongly believes in the relentless pursuit of innovation and excellence at all levels of activity, serving to the society with atmiyata and devotion. Justice Vineet Mathur, a BSc LLB from Jai Narayan Vyas University, Jodhpur, began his legal career in 1993. And comes from a family of lawyers and judges from Jodhpur. Justice Mathur, during his illustrious career as the Assistant Solicitor General of India from the year 2004 to 2014, Additional Central Government Standing Council from 1995 to 2004, Senior Standing Council, Central Excise, Customs and Service Tax Department, and Standing Council for Rajasthan High Court. He has vast experience in the areas of constitutional law, civil law, criminal law, municipal law, land revenue law, arbitration, service law, laws pertaining to Panchayati Raj institutions, to name a few. Much before the pandemic, in August 2019, the High Court bench comprising of Chief Justice Sri S. Ravindra Bhatt and Justice Vineet Mathur, in a unique initiative, held a hearing through video conferencing. The bench remained present in the courtroom at the principal seat at Jodhpur, while the counsels of petitioner and respondent argued from Jaipur. Justice Mathur is an avid sports person and has represented the cricket team of the Bar Association Jodhpur in various cricket tournaments. Participants are advised to ask their questions using the Q&A or chat box. May I now request Honorable Mr. Justice Vineet Kumar Mathur to address the gathering. Sir.
Thank you, Madam. A very good morning to General P.K. Sharma Sahib. It's long time we have seen each other, but it's a wonderful gesture of General Sharma Sahib to have invited me to address this webinar, as we have worked together for a pretty long time, and I am grateful to him for keeping live contact ever since. General Sharma is an asset to the Indian Army and to the nation. His stature is very, very high. I know because I worked with him. And I can very proudly say that Amity University is really benefited by his presence, and the boys and the students will have a great vision in their future.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Grateful to you.
Sharma Sahib, this is a morning which will be remembered by me for a long time, because
grateful. Very grateful.
My my coming to your university and interacting with the children really refreshes me of my good old days. And today's topic which you have chosen, role of judiciary in upholding constitutional mandate, I can proudly say that as a member of the bar and now of course the member of bench, I can evaluate the contributions of bar and bench for upholding the constitutional mandate. Judiciary as a whole, yes, is, we all know, by the framers of the constitution have been said to be the watchdogs, and in this country I can proudly say that we are fulfilling the expectations of the people by relentlessly doing our job with utmost sincerity. Friends, a very good morning, and welcome to the webinar today. Role of judiciary in upholding constitutional mandate. As we know, the mandate is a Latin word, which means an order or an instruction. There are three pillars of the Constitution: legislature, executive, and judiciary. Now, the framers of the Constitution have very wonderfully authored this document, which in my opinion is Gita, Bible, or Quran for governing our country. How the governance is to be done by the governance, what will be the rules, what are the parameters, what are the rights, what are the duties, and how the government functionaries will have to perform their acts, which has been beautifully enshrined and mentioned in our constitution. Basically, the divisions, I should not say divisions, but basically all the three wings have been given different duties. Of course, they are interlinked. Of course, they have to work in harmony, but there are clear demarcations of each, and each wing has to perform its function to fulfill the supplements which others have left, the gaps, because all the three wings are interdependent on each other. These are the three powerful institutions in which there are no written checks and balances, but the framers of our constitution have given enough safeguards to keep the each individual wing in its own parameters to work in its own boundaries, and they are checking the balance of the other in one way or the other. Of course, there is no clear separation of power, but there are provisions which eventually guides us, which eventually tells us the parameters in which we have to function. Friends, the Indian Constitution, the concept of judicial review is based on the paramount principle, be you ever so high, the law is above you. All the three wings have to work to fulfill this paramount principle, which our forefathers have documented so beautifully on 26th January 1950. Now, first of all, I'll tell you the concept of judicial review and how it developed, because the judicial review of laws and administrative actions, the essential part is based on the basic structure doctrine. The various judgments, right from Golaknath versus State of Punjab, where the Honorable Supreme Court in 1967 has ruled that Parliament cannot curtail any of the fundamental rights enshrined under the Constitution. Then in Keshavanand Bharti versus State of Kerala, the Honorable Supreme Court has clearly defined 368(1), where the constituent power as the power to amend any provision of the Constitution by way of an addition, variation or repeal, as long as it does not tamper with the basic structure of the Constitution of India. It reiterated that the constituent power must be exercised by the Parliament itself in accordance with the procedure laid down in the Article 368. Then the celebrated case of Indira Nehru Gandhi versus Raj Narayan, where the Honorable Supreme Court has declared Clause 4 of Article 329A unconstitutional, which said that the Supreme Court or the courts will have no power to entertain the jurisdiction for elections for the post of President, Prime Minister, Vice President and Speaker of the Lok Sabha. The basic concept which on the basis of these judgments says is Constitution of India does not limit the rule of judicial review. The Honorable Supreme Court has gone to the extent of holding that there is no decision which is unreviewable under the Constitution. Judicial review is defined as the power of the court to determine whether the acts of legislature and executive are consistent with the Constitution or the constitutional values. And the third is the concept of judicial review lies in the supremacy of the constitution of land. Since judiciary is the guardian of the constitution, thereby it is under its purview to check actions which are inconsistent with the constitution. Judicial review makes the judiciary to oversee entire action phenomena, decision taken, and the process in making the decision of legislature and the executive. And that is why it is called the watchdog of the Constitution. Article 13, friends, you must be remembering, Article 13 very categorically defines that what will be the parameters and the laws which are inconsistent with or are in derogation of the fundamental rights will be void. And the clause 2 says the state shall not make any law which takes away or abridges the rights conferred by this part, and any law made in contravention of this clause to the extent of contravention be void. So the framers of the Constitution have, as per Article 13, given this power to the judiciary to declare any decision or law or act of legislature or executive which is inconsistent or in derogation with the provisions of Constitution to be void. And that is why the role of judiciary is so important, that this wing has been given special power to review all the actions of the government, that is executive and legislature both. You will remember that Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, who chaired the draft committee of the Indian Constituent Assembly, had characterized the judicial review as the heart of the Constitution. Because if there is no power of judicial review, then virtually it will be the judiciary will be in a way only to pass the orders which will have no teeth. If you really see the background of judicial review, the Indian Constitution assumes a very significant importance, because more particularly, since we have inherited the independence from the Britishers, who were ruling us prior to 1947, because in Britain there is no written law, there are no written constitution, and the courts are only to remain adjudication to the executive actions only. They can't in Britain there is no authority which has been given to the judiciary to uphold or to see the acts of parliament. The supremacy of the parliament has been given more and higher pedestal than the judiciary. Similarly, if we really see the history of United States, then in United States the basic judgment which has given the power of judicial review to the American courts dates back in the year 1803 in the case of Marbury versus Madison, wherein the Honorable Supreme Court has given decided three questions. Out of three questions, two questions have been decided, and they have been given the power to review the. It is said that the Supreme Court, by virtue of that judgment, has assumed the power of judicial review in America. But nevertheless, the very recent events which are taking place in the United States of America, we all have seen the Supreme Court taking control of all the situations, and they are deliberating on the issues which are being brought before them, including the issues of elections. After the independence, there are certain judgments which have gained significance in the history, because today, if we look back and see the growth of our process of judicial review, then we will see that in the case of Golaknath versus State of Punjab, the court has held that the parliament could not amend the constitution to take away the rights provided under part 3 of the constitution. That is a celebrated judgment of 1967, wherein the Supreme Court has pronounced that the part 3 of the constitution cannot be abridged. Of course, there were certain hidden tussles between the legislature and the judiciary, because you will remember that 24th amendment was made in the constitution, which declared that parliament amend the powers of the parliament are not restricted. But again, the action of the parliament came before the scrutiny of the Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Keshavanand Bharti versus the State of Kerala, where the powers of parliament to amend the constitution is not restricted. However, these powers were couched with the doctrine of basic structure. The court observed that the constitutional amendments are to be done keeping in mind the basic structure of the constitution. This judicial pronouncement has created a Lakshman Rekha for the parliament, which should always be respected while undertaking any amendment in the constitution of India. Then the famous case of Minerva Bills, where again the Lakshman Rekha of pronounced by the Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Keshav Bharti has been reiterated, and the Supreme Court again has said that the basic structure and the basic fundamental thing that by making amendments they cannot destroy the basic structure of the constitution. Then again, friends, the famous case of SP Sampath Kumar of 1987, where it was said that the judicial review was a basic and essential feature of the constitution, and if the power of judicial review was absolutely eliminated, the constitution would lose its basic structure and independence. Because as I said earlier, if the power of review is not there with the courts, then what do we do? Then the actions of legislature and the executive are assuming unbridled powers. And if there is nobody to check their actions, then whatever they whatever they say or whatever they do are having no checks and balances. In the aforesaid judgment, it was further stated that if a law made under Article 323A1 were to exclude the jurisdiction of the High Court under Article 226 and 227 without setting up an efficient and effective alternative institutional mechanism for judicial review, it would be violative of the basic structure and hence outside the constituent power of the Parliament. Then the famous case of L. Chandra Kumar, which is a 7-judge constitutional bench judgment, that again reiterated that the power of judicial review over the legislative action vested in the High Courts under Article 226 and in the Supreme Court under Article 32 of the Constitution is an integral and essential feature of the Constitution, constituting part of its basic structure. In light of various judicial pronouncements discussed above, the powers of judicial review remain intact with the Indian judiciary to maintain the checks and balances in the ecosystem of the democratic form of governance. The basic fundamental thing which give rise to the philosophy of judicial review is to establish fairness in the administrative action, to protect the guaranteed constitutional fundamental rights, and lastly, to rule on questions of legislative competence between the center and the states. Now, that is why the out of three limbs of or wings of our constitution, judiciary significantly gains importance, and it is expected from judiciary that the actions, the performances, the orders, the governance, and in furtherance thereof, whatever they do, are made to scrutiny by the courts, by the judiciary. And that is why the judiciary is vested with the power of judicial review. Review includes everything. Of course, the lines which are drawn, it is expected from judicial side pronouncements that the Lakshman Rekha, which is stated to be maintained by the Parliament, is also first maintained by the judicial system itself. So we have to work in such a fashion that the harmony between the three wings is maintained, and the duties and rights which has been casted upon the judiciary are fulfilled within the four corners provided and should not be crossed by each one of us while dictating the orders, or we should not cross the Lakshman Rekha as propounded by the Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Keshavanand Bharti's case. Because what we say for others has to be applied by the judicial system first in the house for themselves. Friends, I have divided the Indian judiciary, in the reviews, in 7 columns and in 7 wings, we must say, in 7 directions, the judicial review takes place of the wings which I have segregated which I have divided is the judicial review of the administrative action and policy decision, judicial review of economic policy, judicial review of decisions based on expert opinion, judicial review of subordinate legislation, judicial review of contractual cases, judicial review in disciplinary proceedings and quantum of punishment, and suo motu judicial reviews. on the broader spectrum, these are the spheres in which we normally exercise our power of review while checking or while considering the actions of legislature and executive. Now we'll take up each wing and I'll try to summarize that what are the boundaries on which we can deliberate, what are the lines which we have to keep in mind while passing the orders, as on each subject there are different parameters, there are different guidelines, there are different significant public importance and public welfare which have to be kept in mind while passing the orders. Because in all these seven wings, the same yardstick or same parameters are not generally applicable. We have to keep in mind so many factors while dealing the subjects, that what we are deliberating, what the points are being argued, and what are the lines we have to keep in mind. As far as administrative action and policy decisions are concerned, that is our first point. There is famous Venusbury's case, if you remember, Associated Provincial Picture Houses Limited versus Venusbury's Corporation, in which it is considered to be the landmark. And in this case, the court held that it could not intervene to overturn the decision of the defendant simply because the court disagreed with it. To have the right to intervene, the court would have to conclude that in making the decision, the defendant took into account factors that ought not to have been taken into account, or the defendant failed to take into account factors that ought to have been taken into account, or the decision was so unreasonable that no reasonable authority would ever consider imposing it. While interpreting the term reasonableness, the court has given a broad interpretation to mean that and include that a person or authority entrusted with a discretion must direct himself properly in law while taking decision, must call his own attention to the matters which he is bound to consider and avoid delegating the same, must exclude from his consideration matters which are irrelevant and which may cause prejudice to his decision, and decision should not be so absurd that it strikes the conscience of any sensible man. The principle of judicial review of administrative action was further summarized in a number of cases, of which some of them are Council of Civil Service Unions versus Minister for the Civil Services, then Union of India versus N. Ganayaguthum, and Munarch versus Infrastructure. You will find number of cases on the point, but the settled proposition which ultimately crystallized was that the policy decision taken by the state or its authorities or instrumentalities is beyond the purview of judicial review unless the same is found to be arbitrary, unreasonable, or in contravention of the statutory provisions, or violates the rights of individual guaranteed under the statute. So these are the pronouncements which are basically guiding us to take a call while dealing with the matters on the subject. The policy decision cannot be in contravention of the statutory provisions for the reason that if legislature in its wisdom provides for a particular right, guaranteed or benefit, etc., the authority taking a policy decision cannot nullify the same. Therefore, the judiciary steps into on those points to see whether the decision taken is fulfilling the provisions of arbitrariness, reasonableness, and they are not in contravention to any statute under which the same are being taken. The second aspect, the review of the economic policies. You must be remembering the landmark cases of R.K. Garg versus Union of India and Balco Employees Union's case, then Federation of Railway Officers Association versus Union of India. In all these matters, the Supreme Court has dealt with the powers of the judicial review, which can be gone into by the courts. The Supreme Court has observed that possibilities of abuse alone cannot itself be a ground for invalidating the legislation, because it is not possible for any legislature to anticipate any abuse while framing the same. The court must therefore adjust the constitutionality of such legislation by generality of its provision and not by its crudities or inequities or by the possibilities of abuse of any of its provisions. In Balco's matter, the economic issues have been said to be always an element of trial and error, so long as trial and error are bona fide and with best intentions. Such decisions cannot be questioned as arbitrary, capricious, or illegal. The Supreme Court, while adjudicating these matters, have given some latitude to the government, because it is said that the fiscal policies normally are framed by the government, keeping in mind lot of factors which sometimes are not right to be adjudicated, and some latitude for certain considerations are given to the government. Then the third wing is the review of subordinate legislation. Now in this wing, you remember the Indian Express Newspapers Private Limited versus Union of India, wherein it was specifically observed that a subordinate legislation may be questioned under Article 14 on the ground that it is unreasonable. That is unreasonable not in the sense of not being reasonable, but in the sense that it is manifestly arbitrary. Now, different parameters have been applied for this principle, and we have to possibly prove the arbitrariness on the face of it. It cannot be assumed or presumed. Then the Supreme Court had decided a number of issues in the state of Tamil Nadu versus P. Krishnamurthy. The Supreme Court has laid down the parameters of judicial review of subordinate legislation, and summarizing the principles, they have said the lack of legislative competence to make the subordinate legislation, violation of fundamental rights guaranteed under articles of the Constitution of India, violation of any provisions of the Constitution of India, failure to conform to the statute under which it is made, in exceeding the limits of authority conferred by the Enabling Act, repugnancy to the laws of the land, that is any enactment, and manifest arbitrariness, unreasonableness, to an extent where the court might well say that the legislature never intended to give authority to make such rules, are the principles on which the judicial review of subordinate legislation can be touched upon. Then the fifth limb is in the contractual matters. The famous cases of Sterling Computers, reported in AIR 96, wherein the Honorable Supreme Court has said that the contracts entered into on behalf of the state, the court is concerned primarily as to whether there has been any infirmity in the decision making process. The court cannot examine the details of the terms of the contract which have been entered into by the public bodies, and the state authorities. The courts have inherent limitations on the scope of any such inquiry. Then in Tata Cellular's case, again, Supreme Court has said that court can interfere if the order is affected from the arbitrariness or bias or the actuated by malafide. Now, these are the basic principles and the limbs in which judicial review can be made of the decisions. And the limitations which have been prescribed by the authoritative pronouncements of the Supreme Court from time to time are kept in mind while deciding the issues at hand. Then on the sixth pedestal comes the judicial review in disciplinary proceedings and quantum of punishment. Now there are hundreds of judgments on which the guidelines have been framed, rather guidelines have been made by the respective departments. And as we know, the sensitivity of the departments also plays a vital role while deciding the process of decision-making process in the case of individuals. Because disciplinary proceedings and quantum of punishment from one institution to another institution is very different. And the yardsticks which has been provided in X department cannot be applied on the similar footings to the other departments. Therefore, this is also subjected to, you can say, rather more diversified opinions have been expressed by the courts, taking into consideration the facts and circumstances of each case. As I'll give you an example, that there are we were made to call for the records of the court martials in the court, and there were certain parameters which were being highlighted in the court, and the courts have appreciated that the principle which has been applied while deciding a disciplinary case in a in a department of the government of India, LIC, cannot be applied on the same pedestal with the army or with the sensitive wings of the intelligence bureau or other departments. And therefore, the scope of judicial review in each individual case is different. And the courts in the country very well appreciates that what are the constraints under which a particular decision is being taken. The basic fundamental thing which has to be kept in mind in view of the number of authoritative judicial pronouncement is that a statutory functionary has an implicit obligation to apply his mind to pertinent and proximity matters only and eschewing the irrelevant and remote. Otherwise, it would be said that the authority had acted unreasonably and in bad faith. The discretion must be exercised by the authority judiciously. Purpose of judicial review is to ensure that the delinquent receives fair treatment and not to ensure that the conclusion which the authority reaches is unnecessarily correct. The court does not have the power to reappreciate the evidence and reach to its conclusion. Now, there are number of issues on which you will find diversified opinions, but my personal view is that each individual case has to be looked into from the facts, and only thing which one should ensure is that a person is extended a fair hearing, because what we are entitled to is only a right to defend ourselves. If we really see, a person should be given an opportunity to prove his bona fides. And the decision-making authority, if has taken this call and has given fair opportunity of defending a person, then the constitutional obligation casted upon him is fairly completed. Sometimes we are placed in a situation where we have come across that holding of an inquiry is sometimes not possible. Then the reasonableness is to be seen. Then the grounds on which the decision is based is to be seen, and the practical difficulty which is stopping the authority concerned for not holding the inquiry should be seen. It cannot be a blanket order that since no inquiry has been conducted, therefore the decision taken is bad in law. There are guidelines, there are rules to the effect. In different service laws, you will find different provisions which gives this liberty to the department to hold the inquiry. And sometimes if the possibility of holding the inquiry is not there, then they may take a decision, but recording the satisfaction, you have to take a call. And a person is entitled to a fair hearing and the fair right to defend himself. So that also is a broad spectrum of the service law, because in service law, if we further go, the division of subjects is to a large extent. We can find lot of principles of natural justice to be complied with basically, and on that principle, what ultimately the sum and substance which comes to the mind of a court is that whether he has received fair hearing and whether the decision of the court, the decision of the authority is based on the sound principles of law or not. So ultimately, fairness and the decision of possibility is to be explored while exercising the judicial review of the disciplinary proceedings process. And then the Supreme Court in number of cases has said that it is not the review of judicial decision, but it is the process which is to be reviewed. Then comes the last limb, which according to me is important, is the suo moto judicial review, or we can say in some of the matters, the public interest litigation. I will club these portions together, because suo moto judicial review, Supreme Court has dealt with in the number of cases, and significant cases are Chairman and Managing Director of BPL versus SP Guru Raja, and one Vinay Kumar versus State of Uttar Pradesh, wherein the Supreme Court has said that it is evident that is in exceptional circumstances, if the actual aggrieved person, because of ignorance, illiteracy, inarticulation, or poverty, are unable to approach the court, a person having no personal agenda may approach the court on their behalf, and the court may examine the issue, and in exceptional circumstances, even if his bona fides are doubted, but the issue raised by him in the opinion of the court requires consideration, the court may proceed suo moto in such respects. So sometimes the situation throws a challenge before the court, and sometimes it becomes really difficult also for the courts to test the veracity, whether a person who is coming before the court is bringing the true facts or what is the truth in the matter. But yes, considering the factual backgrounds, the person who has brought it sometimes forces us to believe that the things are requiring the suo moto action, and we do take cognizance of the same. On the same side, a very big role of Indian judiciary has come into play while exercising the jurisdiction of public interest litigation. It has been deliberated and discussed time and again that the courts are going too far beyond their jurisdiction while dealing the issues. In my opinion, there are certain issues which really requires significance and importance on the subjects like environment. You will see that it is almost affecting each individual. And the provisions, the laws, howsoever stringent they may be, but they are in some way or the other not being followed by the authorities to its letter and spirit. And therefore, when the matters are brought before the court and the directions are issued, sometimes they come under criticism also. But if you will see a number of cases in which the Supreme Court has given directions, the parts of the country have really come up with the studies showing the results that after the directions given by the Honorable Supreme Court, say in the Aravali mining area or in other Kaveri Basin or in the south, some of the areas, the people have really appreciated the directions and the people have really said that although the rules, the regulations were there, but somehow by the interference of the court, by the interventions of the court, the machinery which was otherwise lying in slumbers have woke up, and they are doing a great work of preservation and prevention as far as the environment is concerned. The other issues which the public interest litigation is doing favor is, this is on the national level, I must say. And even on the local issues, if you will see that some of the issues which are brought to the light of the court and very small issues of preservation of the ponds in the lakes and ponds, preservation of the river basin in the local areas, because those problems are really not addressed by the executive and legislature to the extent which they really should. But by the intervention of the courts in the public interest litigation, they are doing a great service as far as the preservation of the ponds, rivers, and basins are concerned. So that is another area where the judicial review is proving very, very beneficial for the public at large. You see, ultimately, the goal of the judicial review is to reach to the benefit of masses, to the best of their ability, and to give them whatever is due, whichever constitution provides. So ultimately, the constitution also rests on the fundamental principle that the society should have proper orders, the common man should get his peace of life, the common man should get the liberties which are enshrined, which otherwise in a normal living standard, the person is entitled for his basics. And based on those principles, the dynamics of the society changes. We will see, I will come with the cases where where right to privacy, the recent Supreme Court judgment in the case of Puttaswamy, you will really surprise that today the right of privacy has gone to what extent. And then again, I will come to the case of the Honorable Supreme Court recently in the case of access to internet and free speech. Now, today we are in an era where internet has become the right to speech. You see, there was a time when there was no, the telephone facilities were not there, forget about the mobiles, and the publications, people were at large informed. Right to information was basically, or right to the news was only the either the radio or the print media. And when the famous case of Sakal Papers judgment. Now the time has come where when we are dealing with internet and in the state of Jammu Kashmir, if the internet is not being provided, it is being challenged before the Supreme Court that right to freedom of speech is being taken away. So these are the dynamics of our society which kept changing and which tell us to modify the fundamental thing of judicial review and what the society needs today. Today we are in an era where the dynamics of society has changed, and accordingly the problems which are brought to us are to be viewed with the angle which the society needs today. We do get the precedents are of great help to us, but ultimately we have to see the practicalities of life today. And while reviewing the orders of the government and the legislature and the authorities, we have to keep in mind the purport in which the laws have been framed. The Vishakha case has given new dimensions. Therefore, the judicial review is not static. Judicial review of the decisions keeps the ball rolling as far as the judicial pronouncements are concerned. The thought process changes, and accordingly we have to change our mindset also to tune with the changing atmosphere, the inventions which are being made today, the gadgets with which we are dealing today. And these, of course, the new inventions have brought the new problems for the society. So we cannot stick ourselves with the old theories, and just because there are two Supreme Court judgments, we cannot say that no, this view is not possible. The views are required to be changed. The views are always required to be looked into from the present day scenario. What are the problems? What the society, what the challenges are being thrown to us? And what is the society actually is expecting from the judiciary? The legislature or the executive are functioning in an atmosphere, keeping in mind, it is the basic thing that they have to keep in mind, that what is the need of the society in consonance which they are framing laws and are being implemented. But at the same time, when the question is thrown or when the matter is brought before the courts are also equally required to respond to the present day scenario. We can't take a very old thought process, and we cannot keep ourselves bound in those earlier precedents. We have to change with the society. We have to change our mindset, and the reviews are there. Reviews are to be done, keeping in mind the need of the hour, the need of the society today. The right to privacy, which is the latest judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court in Puttuswamy versus Union of India in the Aadhaar case. The Honorable Supreme Court on two key points, that is right to privacy, has said that the Supreme Court confirmed that right to privacy is a fundamental right, and that does not need to be separately articulated, but can be derived from Article 14, 19 and 21 of the Constitution of India. It protects an individual from the security of, from the scrutiny of the state in their homes, of their movements and over their reproductive choices, choices of partners, food habits, etc. Therefore, any action by the state that results in the infringement of the right of privacy is subject to judicial review. Now, these were not the considerations in the earlier judgments. These are the latest innovations. The Aadhaar is latest innovation. It has thrown a challenge before the courts to deal with the issue in a latest manner. Then at the same time, the Supreme Court has also said that it has got reasonable restrictions. You cannot have an absolute right. And if you will really see Part 3 of the Constitution does give you the right, of course, but those rights are not unbridled. Those rights are having their own reasonable restrictions. We can't say that, no, because I have a right, I can proceed like this. You have to deal with it, keeping in mind the theory of reasonable restrictions also. And this right to privacy, this again, it was never considered, it never was a chance on the earlier occasions because of Aadhaar, and Aadhaar is also based on certain new innovations. So Aadhaar was new innovation, which was being the creation of the legislature and executive. It has thrown a new challenge, giving rise to right of privacy. So deliberations have to be done today, keeping in mind what the right of privacy should be. And therefore, the Supreme Court has beautifully dealt with and has given the parameters on which the right of privacy can be operated upon. Then, very interestingly, the Office of the Chief Justice of India has also been brought to the Right of Information Act. Now, earlier view, which was prevailing in our country, was that not everything is secret. The judicial system was, in a way, was not very open. The deliberations, the consultations, and lot many things were not brought to the public domain. But this is also a change. When the Right to Information Act was brought to the statute book, it has given right to the people of this country to know what is being done and accept the sensitive informations. Of course, there also the reasonable restrictions are there. But generally speaking, the Right to Information Act is also an innovation of the recent past, where the people of this country have been given a right to know what is happening in our country, what the authorities are doing, how a particular decision has taken place. Because sometimes in the past, these were never the challenges which has been thrown. But yes, this is a new challenge which was thrown for the scrutiny of the judiciary. It has given a thoughtful review, and those areas which were not really open to the information have also been made to the public to have their access. Of course, the checks and balances are there. Then the recent judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court in the Sabarimala's case. Now, this was a tussle between the right to worship and right to personal liberty. Now, very interestingly, the courts have been faced sometime with such delicate issues, but for over the period of time, the challenges which has been thrown to the judiciary have been accepted. And I can say it with proud that Indian courts have very upfront decided the issues, taking all precaution. And welfare of the public at large. The Sabarimala judgment, of course, the Honorable Supreme Court has, while deciding the matter, held that the denial of his of this right to women significantly denudates them of their right to worship. It has held that the custom as a form of untouchability cannot be allowed under the Constitution, and Article 17 certainly applies to untouchability practices in relation to lower caste, but it will also be applied to the systematic humiliation, exclusion, subjugation faced by women. It was held that prejudice against women based on notions of impurity and pollution associated with menstruation is a symbol of exclusion. The social exclusion of women based on menstrual status is a form of untouchability, which is an anathema to constitutional values. In any event, the majority view held that the practice of excluding women from the temple at Sabarimala is not an essential religious practice. The court must decline to grant constitutional legitimacy to practices which derogate from the dignity of women. Now, very interestingly, of course, Sabarimala judgment is a majority view which I have read, but at the same time, we cannot lose sight of the view taken by the minority view by none other than Justice Madam ne jo view liya hai, that that view is also given a thought process, and the fairness and the impartiality in which the views have been expressed can be seen, that the courts have expressed their views keeping in mind the larger public interest. Then, as I said earlier, the access to internet and free speech, the Supreme Court in the case of Jammu Kashmir, where the directions have been given to review the restrictions on the communications imposed in Jammu and Kashmir, have said that the freedom of speech and expression and the freedom of practice any profession or to carry on any trade, business or occupation over the medium of internet enjoys constitutional protection under Article 19(1)(a) and 19(1)(a)(g). The judgment establishes the internet services as an important medium through which the fundamental rights to free expression and occupation is actualized. This is the change which I mean to say impress upon, that in the changing society, the dynamics have changed from the newspaper days to the internet days. Today, we are dealing with very high, I must say, gadgeted problems. The cyber laws, the codified laws which are prevailing in the country today, they needs to be upgraded now. A different outlook has to be given to the problems which are being faced today. So the review of the provisions of our laws, keeping in mind the boundaries of the Constitution, are the paramount and of vital significance for the courts to assume today. I must really appreciate that prior to 1947, the framers of our Constitution has given us a wonderful document and has foreseen the problems in the 40s, that what the country is going to face. And look at the beauty of the Constitution today. It caters almost each and every segment, right from Panchayati Raj institution to the office of the President of India. It has been codified. The midnight oil which has been burned by the framers of our Constitution really shows the great work which they have done. A book which has continued governance of this country, and mind you, the country which is full of diversities. The work has been codified for the best governance by the governing concerns in the codified manner. And the beauty of the Constitution is that it is always amenable to amendments. It is not a straitjacket formula which says that if this happens, the other provision will become redundant. With the changing world, with the changing society, societal patterns, we have amended our Constitution from time to time. And those amendments which have been brought into the statute book also somewhere down the lane teaches us that our forefathers have kept in mind that these are the basic fundamental things which are to be kept in mind while amending the Constitution also. Therefore, in my humble view, the role of judiciary in these changing times has rather gained a vital and a very significant importance to uphold the provisions, and based on judicial pronouncement which shows a clear and categorical exercise of constitutional mandate, the power of judicial review is apparent that the Indian judiciary has also maintained a self-imposed restriction on its own and have not exercised the valuable mandate given to it in arbitrary manner. The entire evaluation and exercise of discretion in the form of judicial review is always restricted with absolute consciousness, and the same has guided with the principles which are developed with the passage of time by way of various judicial pronouncements. The vital wing of the three pillars, judiciary has an extra duty to take care of the two other wings. And it is not like this. When the judgments have come, then the legislature at point of time, some of the times, have filled in the gaps by bringing amendments which has been left open by the judgments. The civil this 100th amendment of this CPC, the other criminal, the amendments in our criminal procedure code, they shows that equally with judiciary, the legislature is also keeping in pace with the changing times, and the gaps which are being filled by the one wing are being taken care of by the other. Therefore, in the present day scenario, the judiciary is the most important pillar, I must say, which is having the judicial review and to check the actions of the governing authorities, that is legislature and the executive, and therefore to uphold the constitutional mandate, the judiciary is given an inch higher than the other two wings, just to oversee the constitutional provisions are to be upheld to its best as enshrined by our forefathers. I am grateful to General Sharma and Madam and the MIT University for having invited me for this wonderful afternoon and to be with you. I think in a short span of time, I have tried to cover almost all issues of judicial review, but if something is more, to be added, then probably we'll have one more sitting.
And there are some questions, some very, very interesting yes. questions that have come up. If Lordship has time and if...
because I only have summarized this, and I want that let us have more deliberations than because these are the fundamentals which everybody can read or everybody can have. But the thought process which must emanate from the discussion is more important.
Yeah, Monica, please,
Before I proceed with the questions, Your Lordship, thank you very much for your insightful thoughts and for igniting the minds of all the participants. The questions I see, they're just coming up, and I will try and put them as best as possible to Your Lordship. Your Lordship, there's a question by one of the participants, Ratan Kaul. Mm-hmm. They're asking that prepositions and maxims have evolved in the process of judicial review. Among many, one need to understand the difference between judicial activism, judicial overreach, and judicial adventurism. Can Your Excellency acquaint about some of the distinctive features in three of them?
Correct. You are right. This is that's what I said, that way back in the year 1973, in Keshavanand Bharti's case, the word Lakshman Rekha has been used. So that has been used for parliament. But what I say is that that Lakshman Rekha equally applies for the judiciary also. There are areas which are specifically within the domain of the executive or legislature, which are not required to be encroached upon by us. I mean, by judiciary. So we should know where to step in. And the deliberations, the discussions which are nowadays in vogue of judicial activism, there is a very thin line. So we have to keep in mind where to stop, what is our boundaries, where should we, to what extent we should go. Ultimately, the fairness and arbitrariness of the action is required to be taken into consideration even while deliberating the issues before the court.
Right. So we have another question from Ms. Asha Meena. She is one of our faculty members. She is asking, to what extent is Article 370 of the Indian Constitution being marginal? Temporary provision with respect to the state of Jammu and Kashmir, temporary. What is the future prospects of this provision in the context of Indian polity? So she is talking about the temporary status that is being given, or the marginal note that says in 370, if your lordship would like to answer the question.
This is, I think it is not proper for me to deliberate, because this is already getting the attention of the court, and to expressing the views on such issues, I should totally
understand. So there's another question from one of our students, Ankur Kamra. He's requesting your lordship to enlighten us about the remedies that could be put in place to restrict the government on unethical use of the government machinery.
Yes, you are right. Because these are the areas where sometimes people even are not aware of. And when these issues are brought to the light, that look here, one wing of the department or government which is otherwise required to perform a particular function has exceeded its limits, or they are not doing it. Then the courts are sometimes, doing the continuous mandamus by, if the public interest litigation is there, or if there are certain issues which are brought to the notice by the authorities or by the officers or by the individuals, they are monitored and appropriate directions are being issued. I know a number of cases in which I was a party to the proceedings. We have given the directions to check all those things, because ultimately it is the taxpayer's money, and it is required to be used in a proper and very ethical manner. But sometimes it is escaping the attention of the persons, or you can say, they must be knowing it, but they are not doing it for whatever reasons known to them. Then yes, these are the specific cases which are brought to the notice, and we are leaving no stone unturned. We are dealing them with iron ends. Absolutely.
Thank you, sir. So we have another question from our coordinator, Mr. Pranjul Pathak. Pranjul sir, would you like to ask, or should I ask?
Yeah, Monica ma'am, you may ask, please.
Okay. So he's asking, sir, the DPSPs are a kind of guidelines for state to comply with. When our apex court makes them justiciable by putting them under the ambit of Part 3, what in your view, would it in your view fall within the purview of activism or overreach of the judiciary, sir?
No, I could not get you.
Pranjul sir is asking that the directive principles of state policy are a kind of guidelines for the state to comply with. But when our apex court makes them justiciable by putting them under the ambit of Part 3, this putting them under the Part 3, is it judicial overreach, judicial activism, or part of the review process?
No, you see, the as I said earlier, the three limbs of the judiciary, legislature, and executive have to function in their own boundaries. Now, if the particular wing is not performing, then the courts step in to make them feel that what the constitution provides and what is their duties. Now, very interestingly, you have raised a very right question, because this equally applies on part three also. Because part three, we talk about we always approach the court for the infringement of fundamental rights. There is one chapter of fundamental duties also, but nobody talks about it. The only thing we have to remind ourselves is that the provisions of the Constitution are to be equally applied by each individual, and not only in the fragmented manner or part three or any other part which is making you devoid of your right. With equal force, we have to apply the directive principles and the fundamental duties. The country will face problem only if either wing is getting imbalanced. If we are putting too much of force into fundamental rights, then naturally somewhere there is abridgment of the fundamental duties. There are somewhere the duties casted upon some of the persons are not being fulfilled, and that is why those are having repercussions into the non-fulfillment of the fundamental rights of some individuals. So directive principles equally binds the government to perform in a particular fashion, but when they are non-performing it, then naturally, as a watchdog of the Constitution, the High Court and the Supreme Court has to step in within their rights to say that these are the directive principles. And these are not the directive principles enshrined in your own local statutes for each individual department which you are trying to implement and show to the people that we have done this. Then if they are not doing it, then they are to be reminded that this is your fundamental duty to complete these aspects.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there's a student of ours again, Medha Varshney. She says that suicide is a result of certain mental illness faced by persons, and when it leads to an attempt to suicide, it is punishable. The person is already undergoing mental illness, and such punishment increases their suffering. The justice system focuses on reformative theory. Therefore, one, she says, don't you think there should be some measures like rehabilitation centers, etc., instead of punishments to cure their mental illness? And don't you think by not taking cognizance on such important matters, the judiciary is somewhere lacking to uphold this constitutional mandate? So
it is, if the issue will be brought to the notice of the courts, definitely we will deliberate. But let me tell you, because in our penal system, there are five theories you must have read about the reformative theory. There are five theories and that is only for the purpose of bringing order in the society. So which theory is more applicable in our country? Unfortunately, I must say reformative theory in our country is not showing very large improvements. I should exceed my jurisdiction by saying that today the society, the country, it needs rather more stringent measures, because what my little experience is, the day-to-day affairs which we are all watching today, you can do anything and get away with it. It is only because of our system. I am not faulting anybody, but the day has come when we need to be more stringent. If you talk about Dubai, if you talk about Saudi Arabia, the offenses which are being committed in this country are, if committed in Saudi Arabia or in Dubai, the consequences which they face are unthinkable. And if you compare those things in this country, you will find that the crime graph in our country and the crime graph in those countries is, there is no comparison.
Right.
Therefore, somehow I personally feel that we need to look into the criminal judicial system with more close quarters, and our country is facing the lawlessness has increased, and the fear of law has gone. If you really see the fear of law, and the moment the fear of law goes, a man thinks, because we cannot lose sight of the prevailing situation in our country, the population, whatever the problems are, but those problems cannot be an excuse to commit an offense, much less heinous offense. And day in and day out, we are watching that what is happening.
Right, sir. Sir, if you permit, sir, some few more questions. There's actually
sure.
So one of our faculty members, Mr. Sanjay Pandey, he is posted a question. He says, it seems that too much power has been conferred on the judiciary by the judiciary itself without proper checks to prevent judicial excesses. And that works to the detriment of not only the constitutional morality and rule of law, but to the basic structure of the democracy itself. Your thoughts on it, sir?
Now, this is a question which has really, gained significance recently. But let me tell you, my personal experience is that if we work within the parameters and the boundaries, there is no doubt that the powers which has been enshrined in judiciary are of a watchdog, are of a limb of the government, which it should be. Because for a strong judiciary, the independence is the sine qua non. And it is we, you see, it is we who have to mend ourselves. Before I give a direction to you to perform your duty in a particular fashion, we have to first apply that principle to ourselves. And that is why the judges, they often, the old judges say that once you are elevated as a judge, you are a young widow. Because you just have to perform your duties. You just have to remain within the boundaries. The moment this is all happening, because some of our persons are crossing those boundaries. Say in PIL, people have, it is such a wonderful thing. It has given wonders, public interest litigation. But some of the cases has also been brought to the notice where people say it is a personal interest litigation. So there, when you transgress your boundaries, when you cross that Lakshman Rekha, you are coming to the, public for criticism. Otherwise, if you perform your duties within the boundaries provided, nobody has any, audacity to any ask a question. Right. Because if judges are said to be, once they are elevated, finished from the society, kuch nahi, aapka seedha kaam, sirf kaam se kaam. But the moment if you start acting as a bureaucrat, if you start acting as a rajneta, public domain, if you get attention, then all these problems start. So self-restraint, in my opinion, is paramount for a judge, howsoever he may be a Supreme Court judge or a Munsif magistrate. Judge is a judge, because everybody performs his duties on its own level. Therefore, it may be a trial court judge or a Supreme Court judge. Self-restraint is the thing which every judge has to and should be imposed for avoiding such kind of questions being raised in the public.
Right. Sir, I'm going to combine this question with, because there are lots of questions around this area. specifically during the pandemic, the judiciary, to what extent has it actually upheld the principle that your lordship began the lecture with, which is be you ever so high, the law is above you, considering the migrant issues, considering the interfaith laws, the marriage laws that have just come up, or some students are asking about the farm laws. You know, the question I think is more in terms of what is the judiciary really, you know, doing about all of these laws that have come up or issues that came up during this particular time period.
Yes, all these issues are getting the attention of the Supreme Court. Matter is pending consideration on all the levels.
Thanks,
and the challenges which are being thrown to either of the High Court or to the Supreme Court, they will be, rest assured, they will be deliberated, they will be discussed, and whatever their lordships in their wisdom will think, you will get the decision.
Right.
Because to my knowledge, I have never seen a judge, howsoever high or low he may be, shirking from his responsibility from deliberating and deciding the issues. Because once you sit on the chair, let me tell you my personal experience, once you are at 10:30 when you are there on the chair, I don't know what is there, but you are just focused for the work.
Right.
What is there in your file, what is there which is coming in your mind, who teaches you, who brings it to your knowledge, how it it becomes possible. At 10:30 it starts, and at 4:30 when you get up, you sometimes feel, oh, ye maine kiya hai kya? So it's all, once you are, if you are conscious of your duties, the challenges which are thrown will very well be accepted and will be deliberated and decided without fear and favor. Rest assured about it. I can assure you on behalf of our all colleagues and the judiciary on the whole that come what may, the challenges which will be thrown to us will be appropriately decided within the shortest possible time.
Right, sir. Sir, again, a lot of questions with regard to access to justice, considering the current movement that we have seen, where, you know, we had to restrain ourselves, lockdowns were placed, and we've gone online. Now we do have, and we know in India, there is a lot of issues with, access to basic amenities also. So in the future, what do you see the future is going to be in terms of how people will be able to easily approach the courts, because ultimately that is where they look up to?
Yes, you are right. This pandemic has thrown us into an era which has rather forced us to go for this, video conferencing. And since it is a upcoming branch, we are doing it for last about 4 months, 5 months. And quite well. I mean, in normal courts, I was hearing about, 180 matters. So equally 120 matters I am hearing as far as VC is concerned. Those who are not filing it, it is their wish. Otherwise, now the changing trend, the people, you see, we are always very reluctant to change.
Right, sir.
So it is difficult. It is difficult because in our profession, sometimes what I feel personally, that if a lawyer appears in the court and he argues the matter in front, it definitely has more impact. It definitely has, because a lawyer's duty is to sit into the or step into the shoes of a, sometimes as a widow, sometimes as a sergeant, sometimes as a general, sometimes as a doctor, sometimes as an architect, and the emotions which are thrown in the court, sometimes the physical appearance sometimes tells you a lot many things. That of course will be changed to this new phenomena, and the upcoming gadgets which are being placed at the disposal of the lawyers as well as judges in the courts, to my satisfaction, it is throwing a challenge, but with the change of mind, with the change of situation, they are proving quite well. They are proving quite well because speaking for myself, my court has now totally paperless. And my and Dr. Pushpender Singh Bhati's court is totally paperless. And we are doing it absolutely with ease.
Sir, if you may allow my follow-up question to this particular aspect, sir. Actually, I want to know that, you know, we have this, and it is, whether I call it a myth or a, you know, thought process that people have, that it's accessible only to the rich. And therefore, the technological advancements that are coming up are going to put a bigger gap in this accessibility. How do we dispel this myth that, you know, there is justice is only for the rich?
No, basically, I don't know what is the foundation for this thought, but suppose I'll give you an answer. Suppose if this is not on VC.
Right, sir.
And if a rich or a poor man comes to the lawyer, right, because sir. Ultimately you will be going to the lawyer.
Right, sir.
So now the myth is that only rich people can afford the lawyer on VC.
Right, sir.
Anna, how is it possible? Because the lawyers are having VC, whether he is going physical or if he is going VC,
right,
that poor person has got nothing to do with it. If in the 5 o'clock or 7 o'clock in the evening, he has to go to an ex-lawyer,
right, sir,
he is not on VC, lawyer is on VC.
Right.
And it is only a change. It is only a very recent phenomena.
Right, sir.
Which you are facing now. One of my colleagues, I had this big library. When I went to my junior's house, he had only one table,
right, sir,
and one laptop.
Right, sir.
So, you know, the basic idea when a person comes to a lawyer is that I must say in a very crude manner, ke jo gaon ka aadmi aata hai, वो जब किसी वकील साहब के आता है तो वो देखता है ओ इतने इतनी सारी किताबें हैं, ये बहुत बड़ा वकील दिखता है.
Right,
तो एक वो साइकोलॉजी है.
हाँ जी.
तो जब अब जो जमाना आया है उसके अंदर ये जो मेरे सामने जो एक ये खुला हुआ है, दिस इज माय एंटायर लाइब्रेरी, दिस इज माय एंटायर फाइलिंग, दिस इज माय एंटायर क्लाइंट कॉन्टेक्ट, एंड नॉट ओनली दिस ऑन मोबाइल फोन. अभी हमारे सामने there are lawyers who are arguing from their Innova car on mobile.
Right, sir.
So that poor fellow has to come to a lawyer only.
Right, sir.
How the lawyer will go to the court is not his problem.
Right, sir.
So right. Rich or poor,
right, sir,
has got nothing to do with it.
Right, sir.
And for that matter, let me assure you, the courts are open for them.
Right, sir.
The doors of the courts are not closed. Even today, if somebody comes with a paper in his hand in the court at 10:30, we do take notice of it.
Right,
and we do take court the paper and say, ki, bhai, kya problem hai teri bata.
Right.
So the doors of this court will never be shut.
Right.
For poor or for rich or for whatever.
Right.
And you just, that poor man has to just go to a right person. All I can say is that I have seen my good old days,
right,
where
sir,
the money has, the end, never been the, I mean, in the mind.
Right, sir.
If a person who is a class 4 employee, can you ask him for a 50,000? That
right,
much humanity all lawyers have.
Right,
and I don't talk of exceptions,
right,
but lawyers do take into account कि आपका क्या status है, आप कहाँ से आए हैं, आप कितना पैसा दे सकते हैं.
Right, sir.
And I believe in a very simple theory कि अगर आप किसी का मन मार के या अनैतिक पैसा लेते हो तो फिर वो इधर उधर ही जाता है, फिर वो सही जगह पे नहीं जाता है.
Absolutely, sir.
इसलिए I myself consider to be a live example of it. And हमारे जस्टिस शिवराज पाटिल साहब थे, वो कहते थे कि 2-4 लाख रुपया कुछ नहीं होता है. सम पीपल पेज एंड सम पीपल प्रेज, एंड प्रेयर्स आर आई एम इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू.
राइट सर. Thank you, sir. Sir, a couple of more questions if your lordship will apply.
Yeah, sure. Please go ahead.
There's a student who Tim he's asking, how do we reconcile the dichotomy between judicial restraint and judicial engagement?
Yes. The judicial restraint, as I told you, is required to be observed, keeping in mind the fundamental principles which has been enunciated in our constitution, the subject matters which are absolutely within the domain of the executive or judicial or the legislature should not be transgressed by a judge while deciding the issue. Those matters which really requires the consideration of the court on the paramount principle of arbitrariness and fairness, and the boundaries which are open for adjudication to the judiciary should be touched. And then you will have no criticism ever at all, I can assure you.
So there's one more question which says, will the role of judiciary be a decisive factor in coming years of globalization and privatization?
I think role of judiciary can never be, never go down, because ultimately the decision making process and the law making process remains with the two other wings. And the faith of the people, most importantly today, even in the past times and even in today, in today's world when we have gone from whatnot, even in today, the judiciary is playing its part very nicely, and people in our country as well as across the globe think that there is some judicial system which will come to their rescue, and there is some adjudication process which is lying in the hands of judiciary to resolve our dispute amicably.
Yes.
And let me tell you, in our country, even the people who are in the rural background or in the cities, you must have heard a very common line. Agar kisi bhi अथॉरिटी से, ऑफिसर से, बदमाश से, गुंडे से, सिविल में, क्रिमिनल में कुछ भी होता है, तो आज भी हमारे देश में लोग ये कहते हैं कि इसको कुछ भी कर लेने दे, मैं इसको कोर्ट में देख लूंगा.
Right, sir.
तो ये सबसे बड़ा कॉम्प्लीमेंट है आज हमारी जुडिशरी के लिए, कि लोगों का जो फेथ है.
Right.
वो आज भी ये कहता है कि ये कुछ भी कर लेवे, मैं इसको कोर्ट में देख लूंगा. तो ये जो जनरल फिनोमिना लोगों का है, आई ओनली प्रे ऑलमाइटी के ये फेथ लोगों का ना टूटे. आई ओनली प्रे ऑलमाइटी के जो विश्वास आप सबने जो हमें आज दिया है, उस विश्वास को हम बरकरार रखें, और उसके लिए हमें कुछ भी करना पड़े, कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल मैंडेट की जो अभिशंसा है उसको ऊपर रखने के लिए, लोगों का जो आज विश्वास है जुडिशरी में उसको पूरा करने के लिए हमें, हमारे को पूरे पूरे ethics, morality, whatever, को ध्यान में रखते हुए we should complete our job of
right
dispensation of justice.
Thank you, Your Lordship. Again, I'm really sorry. Couple more questions only very quickly. I know Your Lordship has answered this to quite a great extent, but yet, you know, I'm getting this question again and again. One of our faculty members, Ms. Neha Mishra, she's asking that in a democratic order, the concept of constitutional morality and judicial value assume myriad dimensions and implies several consequences to the dignity and freedom of the individual. Now, in you know, when the judiciary is pronouncing judgments, in doing so, whether the judiciary is interfering in the fields of governance and in any manner overreaching their power or curtailing this particular you know, individual freedom or dignity when it, you know, gives a particular order which affects everybody.
No, when the challenge is thrown, when the you see, while deciding an issue, the thing which is kept in mind is what will be the effect of, you see, no judgment will be in isolation, no judgment will be in vacuum. Right, it has to take into consideration the factors And if we decide those factors, keeping in mind those factors, the welfare of public at large, then there is no reason for anybody to think, howsoever he may be big or small.
Thank you, Your Worship. One of Mr. R. Jain is asking, one of the critical functions is execution of the decisions, orders, and judgments. Could Your Lordship please enlighten us about what can be done to have the implementation in letter and both spirit?
You see, when a court passes the order, it is expected of the other side or the implementing agency to honor the same and implement it. It is again a question which requires consideration of all the three wings. Unless the three wings are working in harmony, the same cannot be done. And courts are taking contempt matters. We are watching these contempt matters nowadays, that for every order which otherwise is required to be implemented, the person has to file a contempt. And that filing of the contempt, we do take into account that if the order is not complied with, the man is taken to task.
Right, sir.
But the right situation, but the homogeneous condition would be that if an order has been passed, either you challenge it and get it set aside by a higher court, or if you are not challenging it, then it is an order of the court. You have to implement it. Nobody can escape that. Rather, there is no choice.
Right. Your Lordship, we have one of our participants from Amity University, Mumbai, Dr. Gautam. He's asking, relevance of Indian constitution is sometimes challenged. Could you reflect upon this?
Relevance of Indian constitution is challenged, then what are the principles on which the country should be governed?
Right, sir.
It is a book which rules. It is a document which shows the governors the way of governing the country.
Right, sir.
There has to be some statute, there has to be some rules, there has to be some codifications, there has to be some provisions on the basis of which a country is governed. Every society, rather, sometimes codified, sometimes non-codified, for governing certain, even for the managing home affairs and the society, there are certain rules. Some are codified, some are not codified.
Right.
It is very relevant to have the constitution for governance. There is no doubt about it.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Your Lordship. Parting thoughts, sir, what would be your guidance, or your thoughts, and what would you tell our students as a mantra for success, in life, especially, as lawyers, or if they're aspiring to be judicial officers? According to Your Lordship, what is it that they need to be, successful in this particular field?
The most important thing for a budding lawyer or a budding judicial officer is sincerity, honesty, and commitment. Because a lawyer lives so many lives. And be compassionate. If you are compassionate, if you are showing some compassion towards poor, or if somebody has come to you, because people come to a lawyer in a very distressful condition and he's already pained. So only on account of the fact that he cannot pay your fees or for whatever reasons, then the agony of that poor man increases. And I tell you, those who are budding lawyers, just give 5 years to your clients and rest of the life, they will give you what not you can expect. If you are honest, I tell you, this is the biggest asset in your life. sincere a lawyer has to be. And to my mind, honesty, sincerity, and dedication, I mean, if a lawyer is having, nothing is required. मिलता तो सबको अपने भाग्य से है, लेकिन निश्चित रूप से मैं आपको बताता हूं कि इन तीन चीजों का जिस भी बडिंग बच्चे में ये कमिटमेंट है, निश्चित रूप से ही इज हेडिंग फॉर ए बिग थिंग.
राइट, थैंक यू सो मच योर लॉर्डशिप फॉर योर टाइम. मे आई नाउ रिक्वेस्ट मेजर जनरल पीके शर्मा, प्रोफेसर एंड डायरेक्टर एमिटी लॉ स्कूल एंड डीन फैकल्टी ऑफ लॉ एमिटी यूनिवर्सिटी हरियाणा, टू प्लीज प्रपोज अ वोट ऑफ थैंक्स. सर,
Thank you, Monica. Thank you, Pranshul, for organizing this wonderful webinar. It has always been a treat to be in touch, in contact with Justice Vineet Mathur. I have known him since 1995. I mean, he's a very young lawyer, short, frail. And first time when I met him and I said, he's our central government standing counsel. How will he argue in the court? But friends, I am not mincing my words. He is fire and fury when he's on his legs before a bench. It is a treat to have him as our central government standing counsel and as the addition ASG in the Rajasthan High Court. I mean, I have learned so much from him. I was restricted to my own army laws, but it was a treat to have him. There were about 18 counsels, but my most reliable counsel was Justice Vineet Mathur. I mean, if the case is with him, we were so convinced that we are on a very firm footing. And what he told you, honesty, integrity, and hard work. Let me tell you, honesty, if we were weak, he would tell us that, no, this is not correct. And whenever he has argued on behalf of us, with total dedication, with total integrity, and you see the result, today he's amongst the youngest judges of the High Court. And we wish him very, very good luck. We are looking forward to seeing you in the Supreme Court. Seriously, I'm sure most of you know that he comes from a very, very reputed family. His father, Honorable Mr. Justice A.K. Mathur, was the Chief Justice in Calcutta High Court. He came to the Supreme Court. He was there in the Supreme Court for a long time. And then we were privileged to have him as the founder chairperson of the Armed Forces Tribunal. I mean, what today the Armed Forces Tribunal is all his doing. And then the he was chairperson of the Central Pay Commission. So the government had tremendous faith in his father and now in him. So we are very, very grateful to you for sparing so much of time. You have very rightly said that codified laws need to be changed. You know better that law is dynamic. It keeps changing with the changing needs of the society. And judiciary is certainly assisting in that role in upholding the constitutional mandate. There will be comments, there will be aspersions of judicial activism and private internet interest litigation. But we are very proud of our judiciary. And we know, and you rightly said, ki main tujhe court mein dekh lunga is such a comment which speaks volumes for the faith the people of India have in our judiciary. And internationally, our judiciary is respected. And respected because of people like you. So we have tremendous faith in your judicial capabilities. And we are very certain that the judiciary will keep upholding the constitutional mandate as it is doing now. My grateful thanks to all the participants. Very, very interesting and very probing questions which Lordship has replied. Maybe a couple of questions could not be asked. But yes, definitely. I think beautifully covered. And my parting words are, Lordship has been on the criminal bench for last 3 years. We were talking in the morning, and the aim was about 100 judgments in appeals. So he has agreed that the next webinar, which will not be very far, will be on the criminal justice system.
Sure.
So and that will be very, very interesting. We have LLM students who are very keen. They have this stream also on the criminal law. So it will definitely help not only the undergraduates, but the postgraduates and our faculty members also. So once again, thank you to my organizers, Monica Yadav and Pranshul Pathak, and to my IT team, which has done a wonderful job as usual. So Lordship, thank you very much. And we will be meeting you once again.
Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Jai Hind.
Jai Hind.